Deutschland.
Liebe Deutschland.
Here we go. That's perfect. Yeah. That's perfect. You're a natural. There she is.
Hello.
Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
The last time was right before the pandemic. I think at the end of 2019. That was the last time we talked to each other, sadly.
Yeah.
We went to the Oktoberfest, and you seemed to like it. Am I right?
It was so fun. I want to go back so bad. I want to take my husband, because I was telling him about how much fun I had in Germany and Oktoberfest. It was my first real beer that I had, and we got to document that. That was a lot of fun. Yeah, it was great. I had a blast.
We went a dildo shopping that day. Do you have this traditional gown that we bought? Do you still have it?
I do, actually. I almost wore it, part of it, for something. We were having like the theme party, and I almost busted it out, but I didn't. But it was so nice too. It was so just well done, put together. It was so comfy. It was the best.
Do you remember any German words?
No, I don't.
So let's try this. Let's try this.
Oh God, here we go.
I love Germany is Ich liebe Deutschland. Ich liebe Deutschland. Here we go. That's perfect. You're a natural. I have to tell you, and this is not flattery. This is not a compliment. This is a straight fact. You are by far the most requested superstar ever on this show. It's not even close.
Yay.
It's not even close. I mean, Roman Reigns and The Undertaker are second and third, but it's not even close. It's ridiculous. You're by far the most requested. So what that means for me is I collected all the fan questions that I could gather from Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, because you're so popular. And let's get to some fan questions.
Yeah, let's do it.
So this is a good one. In 2019, you also visited Vienna. Do you have any specific memories of that day? That's something Julian wants to know.
Yeah, I actually got to do a horse and carriage ride through Vienna, and it was beautiful, and it was so fun. And I actually just looked at those pictures maybe a couple weeks ago. I was scrolling through the pictures from Germany and Vienna, and it was just beautiful. And it was my first horse and carriage ride, which was really cool, and it was a lot of fun.
What are your favorite Disney movies of all time? That's a question from Lexi Wrestling.
Easy. Goofy Movie. Love Goofy Movie. Love Toy Story. Goofy Movie was actually, the songs from Goofy Movie was actually pretty much the whole soundtrack to my wedding this past couple months. We did Stand Out and Eye to Eye, and my first dance was to Eye to Eye. My husband did a wedding version cover of it. And so, yeah, Goofy Movie, Toy Story, love Monsters, Inc. Yeah, like the Pixar. I'm a big Pixar person, and then Goofy Movie and Extremely Goofy Movie, for sure.
I'm a dad of two, and my girls, they love The Lion King. What about The Lion King?
Oh, The Lion King's so good. It's so sad. It's so good, but it's so sad.
That's right. A lot of Disney questions, because we did that Disney quiz the last time you visited us.
Yeah.
So a Stecknadel wants to know, who are your favorite Disney heroes and also your favorite Disney villains?
Ooh, favorite Disney villains. I love Ursula. She's a whole bunch of sass. Love that. Also, I really like Maleficent. Disney heroes. Technically, I count Buzz Lightyear as a hero because, you know, he saves the galaxy and keeps the universe at bay. Love Buzz Lightyear. I like the movie Hercules, so I would have to say Hercules is a good one. And yeah.
We haven't seen Hercules yet. Is that something I can watch with my girls? They're 4 and 7.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a cartoon. It's the animated one. It's so good. It's not super sad. Oh, there's a good villain in that, too. Hades is a really good villain. He's really spunky and really, he's got some tune to him. I loved Hercules growing up because I loved the music.
Awesome. Here's the double header. First question is from Mark. Next question is from Julian. Which Disney character would you like to play in a movie? And outside of Disney, is there any other movie remake that you would like to be a part of?
So I would love to play Tinkerbell. If we ever did like a live action Disney movie, I would love to be Tinkerbell because I loved Tinkerbell growing up, even in high school. When I graduated from high school, I really just wanted to be Tinkerbell at Disney. I wanted a high wire from the castle at Disney, Florida. But I didn't do that. I would love to be Tinkerbell. And then any remake of a movie. I don't know. I would love to just be in some kind of, any kind of horror movie I think would be fun, or a rom-com. I would love to, oh, maybe I would redo, well, no, because that's an iconic movie. I was going to say I would love to like have like a modern day You've Got Mail, but no one could ever match Meg Ryan in that role. But yeah.
She was pretty good.
Amazing.
Speaking of Tinkerbell, I remember doing the commentary for your first matches in WWE. I think it was 2014, if I remember it correctly. And you were like a WWE superstar version of Tinkerbell. So
I sure was.
Now it's 2022 and you went through all these stages, the bad Alexa Bliss, the good Alexa Bliss, the in-between Alexa Bliss, the Lily to the ring bringing Alexa Bliss, you know, there's so many different phases and facets to Alexa Bliss. What do you think about that evolution in hindsight?
Well, I am so glad that I don't wear a tutu and blow glitter anymore, because that was a time in my life where I really wanted to be Tinkerbell, and I thought that was my moment to live it out, and I'm glad it's over. But it's been a lot of fun, you know, evolving and the character and becoming different phases of myself and kind of branching out to see. For me, it's more of like a personal challenge. What character can I portray? What kind of person can I be? What kind of attitude can I adapt and kind of add that in my Rolodex of things?
There were a lot of questions about the wedding, as you can imagine. And you mentioned your husband, so I have to get right to it. In all the videos on social media, we could see that this wedding was wild, Julia writes. Besides getting married, of course, what was the most special moment of that day?
For me, the most special moment was probably the first dance, because I didn't know he was going to re-record Eye to Eye, which is one of my favorite songs and from Goofy Movie. And I even have the lyrics tattooed on me somewhere. But that was probably the most special, because it was a really genuine surprise that I didn't know was going to happen. And the fact that he took the time to go to the studio to record the song, to have it ready for our first dance and had it be a surprise, was the really special moment for me. And it was a lot of fun. You know, he had a bunch of surprises set up for the wedding. And, you know, I got to walk down the aisle to the song that he wrote for me to propose to. And I walked down the aisle to that. And it was just like a really special day, just filled with like great people and a lot of love and a lot of fun. It was just so fun.
Beautiful, beautiful. I like it. You spoke of your tattoo. Is that the latest one? You have 17, I think.
I have 17. I have 17. Most of them, so 17, 1, 2, 3, 4, 13 of them are white ink that are kind of hard to see. So I have like one right here. It's kind of hard to see, but it's a rocket and it says to infinity and beyond. But then I also have like a couple black ink ones. So that's my Powerline one from Goofy Movie. If we listen to each other's hearts, eye to eye, stand out. And then I have like a bunch of them. Like my whole back is the white ink and my ribs are white ink. And then I just recently got a new one, which is my husband likes to draw little stick figures of his friends. And he has a bunch of his friends just tattooed all over him in stick figure drawn. And so he made a little logo for our wedding, and it's like a stick figure version of each of us together in a little heart. And so we have that both tattooed on us as well.
Awesome, awesome. Speaking of awesome, The Miz and Maryse were at your wedding. Did they party hard?
They had a bunch. They had a lot of fun. They actually, they were so sweet. They sent me my reception shoes. So they surprised me and sent me these all rhinestoned Chuck Taylor shoes to wear for the reception, because everyone that knows me knows that I'm not a high heel person. I live in sneakers and I live in combat boots. That's it. And so I wore these wedges for the ceremony, but for the reception, I wanted like rhinestone sneakers that I ended up buying. But then Mike and Maurice sent me a cooler pair, so I wore those, and it was so fun. Mike had a blast. He was one of the groomsmen, and I wanted everyone to dance down the aisle and have fun with it. You know, I wanted, like I said, we're playing fun music. We were playing Disney music to walk down the aisle to, so have fun, dance to it. I don't want everyone just walking down all stiff. And Mike was so concerned. He goes, well, what do I do? He goes, because I don't want to, like, upstage you. A total Miz comment, right? Like, he's like, I don't want to upstage the bride. And I was like, Mike, no matter what, when people see my dress and me, you're not going to upstage me. And so I'm like, do whatever you want. Have fun. And they had fun. He walked down with Lena, Naya, and walked down with her. And they just had so much fun. He did his entrance and they had a great time. I'd like to think, like, it was so fun.
That sounds nice. That sounds really nice.
Yeah.
We mentioned your husband a couple of times. There's so many questions about your husband. So many questions came in. For example, this one from Alex. What is it like to have a husband who is also touring and on the road? How does this fit together?
So we have actually been very lucky with our schedules. Obviously, you know, I've been in relationships in the past with people within the company, wrestlers, and, well, all wrestlers specifically, and even being in the same company, our schedules didn't match up, and that was really tough on the relationship. But somehow, when Ryan and I first started hanging out, dating, whatever, our schedules somehow matched up. We were in the same 7 cities in a row, so, like, his shows were in the exact same places we had shows, and... Wow. Yeah, and somehow our touring schedule sometime matches up. And if it doesn't, we both tour on the weekends. So, like, right now I'm in wherever he has a show. And so I'm in the city right now where his show is. And whenever he doesn't have a show, he'll come to where Raw is or where the live events are. So we balance that back and forth. So I'll spend, you know, we spend the weekdays together because our schedules are free during the weekdays most of the time, unless I have media or anything like that. So he tours on the weekends. I also tour on the weekends. And then if we're not on each other's like schedules, we'll just go to each other's shows.
That sounds good. That sounds pretty reasonable.
Yeah.
Wouldn't have thought.
Yeah.
Monica wants to know, this is a short but interesting question. When and how did you find your love for wrestling?
So I grew up watching wrestling. My family loves WWE, always has. My grandma thought she was gonna marry Dusty Rhodes. My aunt thought she was, yeah. My aunt thought she was gonna marry Stone Cold Steve Austin. It's just that was the thing we did on Monday nights. We would get Giuseppe's Pizza, which if you're in Ohio, and I don't even know if Giuseppe's still there. If you ever make it to the States, people watching, and there you go to Ohio randomly, Giuseppe's Pizza, awesome. We'd get Giuseppe's Pizza and watch Monday Night Raw. And for me, I didn't know. I thought people just, like, grew up and became WWE superstars. I just thought that was just, oh, they just grew, like, The Undertaker was born The Undertaker. Like, in my mind, that's how it worked. And so after college, my trainer told me that, you know, WWE was having a tryout. And I was like, oh, my gosh, I'm definitely going to try out for that because – I watched it growing up with my family. My cousins always pretended to be the Hardy Boys and Lita. And what was funny was they'd always be the ones running around chasing each other. And I was always like, leave me alone, stop. And then I was the one that became in WWE.
Nice one. You just strike me as a family person. Do you still consult your parents? Because you're so successful. That's the reason why I'm asking. You're so successful and everything seems to fall into place for you. Do you still consult your parents when you decide certain things or make certain decisions?
Oh my gosh. My parents and I are so close. So super close. I talk to them daily. And yeah, there's a lot of things that, yeah, I consult them pretty much on everything in life because, you know, they had me really young. So I kind of grew up with my parents. And so we've always had this like really close dynamic. And yeah, I definitely wouldn't be where I am without the support of my parents because, you know, when I first started in WWE, I didn't realize how, you know, busy the schedule was. I didn't realize how crazy the training was. I didn't realize, you know, you dedicate your entire life to it. Like for the last, you know, 9 years, all I knew was WWE because we're in a different city, a different day. And when you're not in the, when you're not on the road, you were training and basically just all you knew was WWE. And I remember when I first started, I was so overwhelmed and I was like, you know, cause I didn't have a indie wrestling background. I didn't come from that world. So it was very overwhelming to me. And it was very, you know, I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't have the skills these other women have. And it's a lot. And so if it wasn't for my parents' support and, you know, always like my mom would go with me to the shows and drive me so I could sleep. Because a lot of times you just don't go on sleep. And so if it wasn't for my parents, I definitely wouldn't be where I am today. I mean, obviously I worked really hard to get where I am, but when I felt like I couldn't keep going, my parents helped me in that sense.
That's such a heartwarming statement. I'm getting goosebumps because I hope my kids will say that about me one day. That's really beautiful.
Yeah.
Shout out to your parents. They deserve it.
They're the best.
Stefan, with an interesting question here. Since your return, you are unbeaten in singles matches. How would you describe your feelings when you return to the ring?
I'm always nervous when I return to the ring, for sure. Because let's be honest, I'm not the biggest one in the ring. 5'1", 100 something pounds. Like, you know, I'm not physically intimidating. So it's a little nerve-wracking, but whenever, you know, my music hits, the nerves go away and I just get excited and just try to go out there and do my best and, you know, give as much as I have physically, mentally, emotionally to the match because, you know, we do what we do because of the WWE universe. And if that means, you know, I win, that's awesome. And if I lose, I learn. And I take that and learn for my next match.
Speaking of your new music, do the lyrics have a certain meaning for you?
So the lyrics, that was actually a lot of fun. So my acting coach and I came up with the lyrics, the concept for the lyrics of my music. So I've never really gotten to be super hands-on with my music. You know, our WWE music team is awesome, amazing. You know, they always say, what do you think of this? What do you think of this? What do you think of this? But this time we got to kind of build it from scratch and it was a lot of fun and it got to work a different part of my brain that I've never got to work before. So I've been doing acting classes with my acting teacher Nacho for like almost 2 years now. And so this class, I was like, I need new music. And he was like, well, let's think of some stuff. And I was like, okay. And so we were thinking like, because pop punk is kind of making its way back. And so we were like, why don't we kind of focus around that? And, you know, a lot of concept of pop punk was, you know, you can't control me, you know, anti-authority, you know, I'm my own person, I'm gonna do what I want kind of thing. So that's kind of the idea we went with. And we sent it to the WWE music team, this just a picture of all these notes that we took. And they used a majority of them. And obviously they tweaked them and made them a lot better. But because, you know, I'm not a songwriter, I don't know what I'm doing. But it was really cool to give the concept and have a lot of our personal ideas and see it turn into a full-on WWE entrance music was really cool.
Wow, that sounds creative.
Yeah.
Next question is from Hofer. Becoming Raw Women's Champion again is obviously the goal. I think he's right. How about a second Money in the Bank victory? Is that your next goal? That's what he wants to know.
100%. If I'm able to be one of the people that's in the Money in the Bank ladder match, I would love to do that because obviously it worked out very well my first time around. The last time I was in a Money in the Bank ladder match, I did not win, but this time I'm hoping to be able to come up with some new tactics if I'm in the match and hopefully climb up the ladder and get that briefcase before anyone else.
The experience factor kicking in.
Yeah.
This is a great one from Hannah. Would you rather cash in the Money in the Bank contract on Ronda or the winner of Bianca and Rhea?
Ooh, I would say Bianca and Rhea because here's why. I've faced Ronda before, and I've never really faced Bianca or Rhea in an extended amount of time. The only time I've really faced Bianca was in the Royal Rumble. We were 1 and 2 entrants and got to have a match with her. And then Rhea, the first time I even was in the ring with Rhea was Elimination Chamber in Saudi Arabia. And I think they're both just, I mean, all three women are stars for sure, but I would love to have the opportunity to face Bianca or Rhea, because I've already faced Ronda so many times, and that was a lot of fun. But I think, you know, the Raw brand is where I'm focused, and those are the number one contenders.
How strange is that? Now you are the veteran and they are the younger generation. And
this, my gosh, that makes me feel so old.
This happened so fast, you know, where did time go?
I know, I've been in the company now 9 years. Since May 5th, it's 9 years. Crazy, right?
Yeah, I think we started about the same time. I signed in 2013.
Yep.
So, yeah, we're getting old, Alexa.
I got hit with this the other day. Someone told me I watched you growing up, and I was just like... And I realized, I was like, oh my God, they did. Because 9 years ago, someone who was, you know, 20 now was 11 then. So I'm just like, oh my gosh, like that's crazy.
Exactly. Like the last WWE Live event in May, this 20-year-old guy said to me, I am the voice of his childhood. And I'm thinking, that's a 20-year-old guy. How can that be? Well, I'm with the company for almost 10 years now. So
yeah,
makes sense.
Oh my
it gosh. Makes sense. How does it feel to see photos and videos of young fans with their Lily dolls? Mara wants to
love it. I love it. It's so great. You know, Lily was a fun concept to, you know, bring to life. I texted Jason, who does all the work on, you know, the masks that you see on WWE, all of the, you know, the crown that I wore with the black goo coming out of it. Him and his wife did that, and they are incredible talent. And any kind of prop work that you see that's just kind of like a little, like, a little extra special, that definitely comes from them. You know, they did a lot of the puppets for the Firefly Funhouse, Alexis Playground. They came out with Lily. And it was really cool because I texted Jason, and I remember saying, like, I really want a doll to interact with. And he was like, a doll? And I said, yeah, I want a doll. And I was like, I want it to look like someone scribbled her, like a child scribbled her on a piece of paper. She just popped off the page. I was like, button eyes, 3D teeth, want her to kind of look like me, but scary. And they came up with, they showed me Lily, and it was the most incredible thing I've ever seen. And, you know, I was so happy that WWE went for it, because I knew that there was something special about Lily, and the fact that she has resonated with so many people, especially the younger generation of fans, is awesome, because it just shows that they enjoy her as much as I do. And it's a lot of fun to work with Lily, and it's just like so cool. I always just wanted to have, you know, something that people can just, like, you know, tangible, that they can play with, and it's Lily, and it's awesome.
So I'm on the Raw commentary team, and I did the commentary for this Fatal 4-Way match in the past episode. And yeah. I saw you working together with Liv Morgan. Obvious question here. Could you imagine forming a tag team with Liv?
Of course. You know, well, my past has shown I don't do too well with tag teams.
Well, you're a two-time champion.
That is true. That is true. But somehow I always end up having major falling outs with my tag team partners. But I think, yeah, I think it'd be a lot of fun to tag with Liv, especially because she's super talented. You know, we've all seen her videos of her in the ring, and she gets this energy from somewhere I don't even know, because I drink so much caffeine a day and I still can't get to her level of energy. So, like, kudos for that. But she's, like, super talented. And yeah, I think it'd be a lot of fun to tag with Liv, and it was fun working with her in the Fatal 4-Way match. You know, sometimes you gotta, even though if you're against someone, you have to work with them to take down the people who are a little bit stronger, a little bit more powerful. But yeah, I think it'd be a lot of fun.
Sounds good. Sounds good. Yona wants to know, is there a superstar from the current Raw, SmackDown, or NXT roster that you would love to face in a singles match for the very first time?
I'm going to stick with Rhea Ripley. I think she is just a powerhouse and so talented, and I've never really gotten to have a lot of extended time with her in the ring, and I think she's just super talented, super great to work with, and yeah, I would love to face her and see where that goes.
So, let's see. Let's say Alexa Bliss is in the main event at WrestleMania 39. Would Rhea Ripley be the perfect opponent?
Oh, 100%. You know, she's definitely that person that deserves that WrestleMania moment, and especially to main event, because she, I mean, if you look at her, she's a freaking star. And I think that would be a lot of fun. But my ideal, if I was main eventing WrestleMania, my ideal match would be a multi-women match, because, you know, we've seen, you know, there's a couple women who have been able to main event WrestleMania, but I would love it for it to be a lot of the roster kind of thing, like the whole women's roster, because it took the whole women's roster, past, present, and future, to get to that point where women can main event WrestleMania. So I would love to see, you know, kind of all of the women kind of have that moment together. But yeah, I would definitely, if it was one-on-one, I would definitely say Rhea Ripley would be in that conversation for sure.
Sounds cool. That sounds cool. I'm in all the way. Food related questions coming in here. Oh, Mia wants to know, what is your favorite cheat meal? Do you even have cheat meals? I don't like the term, because it's cheat meals. What does that mean? I mean, everybody's got to have a snack now or then.
So I would love to come on here and preach to have a healthy, balanced diet and work out all the time, do all that thing. I used to do that. I was a bodybuilder. I used to do that. My whole life is cheat meals now. So I don't have a cheat meal. Like, my husband and I had to have a conversation not too long ago. He goes, you know, babe, every meal doesn't have to have French fries with it, because I love French fries. That is my thing. I am a French fry connoisseur. I could, if you ask any of my friends, I could tell you what states and what cities have good fries and what cities and states don't have good French fries. Like, I love French fries, and I love chicken tenders. I eat like a child. I love popcorn, chicken tenders, French fries, mac and cheese. Like, that is my go-to. And so I would say I live on cheat days. But I mean, that kind of, I mean, obviously I'm not as lean as I used to be, but I'm happier now, and I eat what I want, and it's fun, and it's nice, and it gives me actually more energy than when I was trying to watch everything I would eat, and I would schedule my whole week around one meal that was, you know, not good for me. But then I was like, why am I doing that? Why don't I just like balance it out, have everything in moderation, and not stress about it? And yeah, it's just, I've just been so much happier that way.
Life is about balance. I'm so happy that you mentioned French fries, because there's a load of French fry questions. And I was thinking, what's everybody doing with the French fries question? But that's French why. Fries Alex, that's his name. He writes, can you describe the perfect French fries?
Okay, so I can't describe the perfect French fries, but I can describe to you my perfect French fries. So my perfect French fry is from a little place in Grove City, Ohio called Memories. And they have the best, they're like fair fries. Like, you know when you go to a fair and they have like the stand that has the fries, and they're just like, they're almost like, they almost taste like they're made in malt vinegar, but they're just so good, and they're crispy, and they're soft on the inside, crispy on the outside, not too much salt, but just enough to give it that little bit of flavor. I will say I used to love, the only other place that had French fries like that was Butcher's Block in New Jersey, but then they changed their fries recently to like these thick steak fries, which are just as good, but they're not the same kind of fries as Memories fries. Yeah, that's like my perfect fry. The fry that's like crispy on the outside, still a little soft on the inside, not too much salt, but just enough. But I don't like when they double fry the fries, because then that's just too much outside coating, and then you lose the flavor anyway. So I could talk about fries all day, but
you're making me hungry. You're making me really hungry. Last
I'm
question.
I'm a French fry connoisseur.
I recognize that. Last question. Let's say there's a new season of the Mixed Match Challenge. Who would you choose as a partner?
Who would I choose as a partner? I'd say The Miz. If Maurice isn't already tagging with him, I'd say The Miz, because he has this presence and just cockiness about him that's just so great and so entertaining. If not The Miz, probably Austin Theory, because he's full of charisma, really talented in the ring, and I feel like we could win some good matches.
Let's think of it this way. You and The Miz and Maurice as a manager, that's even more dangerous.
Oh, that'd be awesome. Or maybe me and Maurice could switch off manager roles. Like one match I would manage, one match she'd be in the ring, and then we flip back and forth, and that'd be fun.
Yeah. Everybody gets their rest. Talk about longevity, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you so much, Alexa.
Thank you. Only one thing.
You have to promise to come back. That was really interesting. That was funny. That was everything. That's like a good portion of French fries.
Yeah. 100%. I promise.
Okay. Thank you so much. And till next time, I guess.
Yeah. Hope to see you soon.
See ya.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.